Okay, so we have some people. Okay. People in the audience, I would like, can you please raise your hand if you prefer the presentation in Spanish? Those in Spanish, please raise your hand. I have the option of Spanish or English. I cannot offer Portuguese. But Spanish, anyone? Otherwise, I do it in English. Okay, we're going for English in that case. So English won. Democracy here is showing. Okay, so welcome everyone to this really relevant event. I would like to first of all thank ICA, the Instituto Interamericano de Colaboración para la Agricultura. Okay, and today we have three, I would say, really experts on the topic of biofuels. And I want to bring, like, I would like to open with a couple of messages, first of all. First, announcing why I'm here, I am from Carla de la Mayora, Deputy Director of BASE. It's a Swiss foundation that we specialize on the development of business models to drive investment to climate solutions. And of course, energy is one of the fields that we work. So this is a topic that's really important for us. Then I want to try to set the scene in terms of what's happening given that we are COP. And we already have seen that how the GAP report is showing that we are not going towards 1.5, not even to 2. So we really need to accelerate and start like assessing all the options that we have to see what can each one of these options like contribute and how we can boost those options. So today for that, we want to talk about biofuels. Why? Because transport is one of the big culprits of like emissions, like more or less a quarter of global greenhouse gas emissions come from transport. And like one of the experts that we have here is on the aviation side, and aviation on its own is around maybe 12% of the total, while like maybe light vehicles around 40+%. Okay, and maritime, that we don't have anyone from the maritime sector, but it's another like 11 to 12%. So it's quite relevant that we have railways, et cetera. So we really want to look at what is the impact of really engaging into this. What can biofuels do for us? So with that objective, I would really like to introduce our like panelists. I'm gonna introduce one. I'm gonna do something. I'm gonna introduce the three of them very like so you have like an idea who's here without like a lot of details. Then I'm gonna go to one by one so they can, I don't know if everyone brought a presentation or not, you're gonna clarify to me that. And then we can engage. And I wanna try to, I'm asking everyone here to really take note of whatever they're saying, because for me, it's really important that when we have panels that we try to incorporate, it's not just three people presenting, how can we bring some topics in common and build something that's much more relevant, I would say. So in that case, I would like to welcome Evandro Guzzi, who's next to me. He's a specialist really in bioethanol, if I'm not wrong, president and CEO of the Brazilian Sugarcane Industry Association, UNICA. Okay. Then connected online, I have Gustavo Idigoras. I hope I pronounced it right. He's a specialist in biodiesel, but he's a president and chairman of the Argentine Edible Oil Association and Grain Exporters Association. And last but far not least, we have Jose Ricardo Botello. He's our specialist here in the aviation, and he is heading the Asociación Alta, Asociación, like Latin American Association for like air transport. We hope I said it okay. So he's the executive director and CEO. So having said that, I would like to invite Evandro. Did you bring a presentation or you are just gonna talk or like openly?
Open.
Okay, so let me give you, I don't, can you test whether that one is working? I'll pass you.
Yes. Yeah. I'm gonna move back. How much time?
I would say 10 minutes or 10 minutes plus.
10 minutes.
Yeah.
Well, I would like to thank for the invitation of ICA. I think that this initiative to develop it, the agriculture, especially toward low-carbon agriculture, low-carbon energy initiative is wonderful. And I see how ICA is working hard in this direction. Then Rosanna, is wonderful to be under your moderation here. I'd like to greeting Gustavo Idigoras, from Argentina, talking about biodiesel. One point only: when I was member of parliament in Brazil, I was president of the biodiesel caucus. By 4 years of the mandate, I was the president of the biodiesel caucus in Brazilian parliament. And of course, José Ricardo Botelho, a Brazilian based in Panama, responsible for the flight transportation and in Latin America, and with a wonderful but challenges important in reduction of CO2. Then thank for that. Well, the role of the liquid, I could say also the gas, because in our sector we are producing ethanol, like a liquid biofuel, but also the biomethane from our wastes. I think that the biofuels have an important role in this process. Each 10 questions that I receive as president of Unica, representing ethanol in Brazil, each 10, 11 are about electrification and the role of ethanol. We journalists and researchers ask me, do you think that ethanol and biofuels anyway will have a future when the world is talking a lot about electrification? And then my answer starts saying the following. We must to distinguish the trend and the technological routes to achieve the trend. This is so important in my opinion. One thing is the trend. Another thing or other things are the technological routes to achieve a trend. Then when someone says me, oh, the electrification of vehicles is a trend, I answered, no, electrification of vehicles is one important route, the technological route to achieve the trend. And the trend is reduction of CO2 emissions. This is the trend. If we don't distinguish these things, it means go to the east, trying to go to the west. Then, if you want and if we need, it's better to say, if we need to reduce the carbon footprint in all the sectors, but especially as Rosanna has mentioned it, in transport sectors, we must put in our hands all the available solutions to achieve the reduction of CO2 emissions. And I would start about electrification. It's a road. In some places will be the best if the electrification was able to reduce the carbon footprint. For example, in India, the 84% of the energy matrix in India is fossil-based. More than 70% of electricity in India, it's fossil-based. The same is in Poland, for example. then to say, oh, we will electrify the fleet, you won't have electric vehicle. You won't have a EV, electric vehicle. You will have a CV, a coal vehicle, because the electricity comes from coal in Poland or in India. But in Norway, for example, with a very clean source of electricity, it makes sense. You will have from 147 grams of CO2 per kilometer of gasoline, of petrol, to 10 grams of CO2 equivalent per kilometer in Norway, for example. Wonderful. They must do this. I represent ethanol, but they must electrify. This is the key point for me in this subject. Besides this, then we are mapped and we saw one important part of the world for what the electrification, like we have in Europe, like we may have in United States, may not be a solution for these countries. 3 billion people, 3 billion people are in these countries. And then we understand that ethanol, I won't say about biodiesel, of course, but biodiesel also, biomethane, for example, will be an important technological road to achieve decarbonization, reduction of CO2. Then, because this we say in Unica, we are part of the solution. We aren't the solution itself, because the solution itself doesn't exist. When we see when we read the reports of international energy agents, they say we need everything in terms of low carbon energy available. We aren't in a moment in the world that we can reject one kind of low carbon energy source. Our experience in Brazil is that it's possible to produce bioenergy in form of ethanol or in biomethane with low carbon footprint, with sustainability, with a solid compromise, with no deforestation. In our sector, deforestation is not a subject, not subject. We approve it in 2017, the national policy for biofuels, and then it's a zero deforestation policy, zero deforestation policy. If you have 10,000 acres, if you have a deforestation of one, all the 10,000 are out of the program of carbon credits. And then deforestation isn't a subject for us. More than this, we aren't food versus fuel. We are fuel plus food, because one important part of our sugarcane and corn areas are available each year to produce other crops like peanuts. We have, for example, with sugarcane, we had the rebuild, rebuild of peanuts crop in Brazil, producing, of course, oil and food. Then our most important role now to finish is to share this experience with other parts of the world, in Latin America, in Africa, in Asia, because in this part of the world, the electrification with batteries in European and US model may not be the best solution. But of course, they need to have a good pathway for agriculture, a good pathway for the generation of nature based solutions in energy. Then we have experience in Brazil. It's a good experience. Of course, we have mistakes and we have to try to address these mistakes, but we have a good experience. And the most important part of our work now is to share this experience with the other countries. Thank you. 47 seconds plus.
Excellent timing, Evandro. And I like, before going to Gustavo, I did like a couple of things that you mentioned, and then maybe I'm going to try to bring them together. But this whole idea of trends and versus technology roads to achieve these trends, I love the AV versus the CV, okay, the coal vehicle. But also what you said, the idea that things depend on the market conditions, on the realities of countries, whether it makes sense or doesn't make sense. So it's not one technology that fits all. It's like a combination of solutions that we really need to take into account. And an element that I'm going to come back to you, because I really want to learn more, and I'm thinking it's going to be a common element for everyone, is the sustainability element of like the biofuels in general. So having said that, I want to welcome Gustavo Irigoyen. Gustavo, I think the best thing is I'm going to let you introduce yourself. Because as Evandro did, because you can really, I think, like, it's a pleasure for me to meet you. It's the first time I'm meeting you, but I want to hear from you yourself, your expertise. And of course, I think you did bring a presentation, didn't you? And it's just behind me. So please go ahead. You have 10 minutes. If you need a little bit more, that's fine. Anything, if you go too long, I'm going to let you know. Okay, thank you. Go ahead, please.
Thank you. Thank you for this welcome. Good morning and good evening. For everyone there too, it is a pleasure, and thank you for the invitation from IICA to attend as a panelist. As Evandro has mentioned before, I'm going to focus on biodiesel, but I think that we can share many of the thoughts that Evandro has already introduced. I have a PowerPoint presentation, as you have watched this on the screen. I'm not sure if I'm able to manage, or do I have any collaboration from there?
No, they need to manage it from here, so just let us know next.
Okay, so and just go to the second one.
Next, please.
The next, please.
Give us 1 second.
Yep, sure.
No, even without tech things, so give us 1 second, because now we can see a black screen, but... It's going to be, there we are. Okay. So is it working to move it to the next?
Yes, please.
1 second, because it went again black. Let's see. There are no signals. So anyhow, in the meantime.
Well, if not, don't worry. Maybe I can try to start with my presentations and giving some specific thought. If you like with that,
Go ahead. Yes, absolutely.
Okay. So when we are talking about biofuels, we are talking about three different kinds of biofuels, worldwide. We are talking about grapeseed biodiesel produced particularly in Europe. We are talking about palm oil biodiesel produced in some Asian countries, particularly Indonesia, Malaysia, and Thailand. And when we are talking about soybean biodiesel, we should focus on Brazil, US, and Argentina. In the case of Argentina, we have a strong soybean value chain. And I think that the slide is finally over there on the screen. So so you can see there, we have a very strong value chain in Argentina dedicated particularly for export. One of the reasons for doing that is not only that we have a large production of soybean, we export around 90% of the total annual production of soybean, because we don't eat soybean and soybean byproducts. So we dedicated soybean production for export. And in the case of biodiesel, when it was the first launch of regulatory condition worldwide around 2007-2008, particularly in Europe and US, we decided to include in our crushing cluster facilities and port and terminals biodiesel plants. So one of the reasons why we have a strong competitiveness is in relation that all of our biodiesel plants are also located in the same area of production of edible oil and crushing plants. So we don't need to have any transport costs. So we reduced GHG emissions due to the fact of that. And the second point is that around 300 kilometers of land, we have more than 28 million tons of soybeans. So we have a very low transport distance in Argentina to arrive to terminals, and then we receive soybean, and in the same terminal, we produce biodiesel. The third condition is that in almost 35 kilometers, we have almost all the installed capacity in Argentina than the total territory of US. So that cluster conditions give us also an extraordinary competitiveness to compete with any country that has local blends or local mandates to produce or to consume biodiesel. So we go to the next one, please. So as the result of that, Argentina have begun dedicated to produce biodiesels to be exported. That was our main goal, but during a long discussion with different administration in Argentina, with different governments, it was implemented a local law to introduce a local mandate, and the current blend mandate is 7.5%. So in our production, more than 50%, around 40% is dedicated for local consumption. And the other is dedicated to export. What are the main markets that we are exporting biodiesel? Then we move to the next slide, please.
Next slide, please.
So we used to have several markets, particularly US and Europe and Peru. There are not several markets authorizing imports, as it happened with bioethanol, also but with biodiesel. There are several restrictions of import in many markets. So right now we have only one market, which is Europe. We are the first supplier worldwide of Europe of soybean biodiesel, to an annual quota of 1.2 million tons. Please, we move to the next one. What are the main conditions that we have to talk about sustainability? Because as Evandro has already mentioned, when we are talking about biofuel, we should see as a solution to reduction greenhouse gases emissions. Where the first condition is the system of production in Argentina. We have 90% of no-tillage system, meaning with that we reduce 40% land erosion with any other system of agriculture production worldwide. And then we reduce a strong reduction of the use of phytosanitary product and also the use of water in the production of agriculture product, particularly soybean. The second point is the local transportation distance. We have around 300 kilometers as an average, with other countries having more than 1,000 kilometers. And the third point is the large scale of industry that we have located in our country. Please, let's go to the next one. Here we have some pictures about the plants, biodiesel plants that we have. All of the biodiesel plants are located close to the river, close to the terminals. So by pipes, we transport biodiesel to vessels. That's the reason why we have very good prices and higher quantities of production. But the other reasons about sustainability biodiesel in the country is that from 2008, we have been accredited and we are given guarantees that all the soybean production dedicated to biodiesel, soybean biodiesel exported from Argentina, has zero deforestation. There are no land conversion in the country since 2008 to fulfill in EU and US import requirements about land conversion. And finally, right now we are adopting a full national platform in order to guarantee that the whole soybean value chain will be free of deforestation. Not only to fulfill a future EU rules, but also to give guarantees locally to our community, civil society, but also to international markets that give guarantees that soybean biofuels, biodiesel from Argentina is free of any land conversion or land use change. Please, then we go to the final slide to give some a specific remark and
each
and
one. Sorry, okay, go ahead.
Yep, okay. So final remarks. There is a strong need to diversify energy sources, plus the decrease in fossil oil production and the search for environmental friendly energy has promoted this strong growth of biofuels industry. Argentina and many other countries, like for example Brazil too, offer important competitive advantage to produce biodiesel. And increased biodiesel production generate also further soy meal surplus for global animal production. This is quite important topics. The old dilemma about fuels against food, there is no true anymore. Because if we have more demand on soybean biodiesel, then we will have more feed materials to feeding animals worldwide. National policies on biofuels should guarantee market access conditions for environmental efficient biofuel production from third countries. And also, we recently launched a document from biofuels industry from Argentina, Brazil, Colombia, Paraguay, and Uruguay, asking to define regulatory framework to ensure the advance of investment in the region. Finally, my final comment about one of the topics taken by Evandro about electricity mobility worldwide. We are convinced in Argentina that developing countries and less developed countries do not have or couldn't afford the level of investment to introduce electricity mobility locally. So the best way to reduce GHG emission in transport is to adopt a full regulatory mandate on biofuels, because we have natural resources to do it. It is clear that reduce more than 70% from fossil fuels, and also it will reduce the level of investment. There is no need for further investment on biofuels if we dedicate it to replace partially fossil biofuels. So thank you for this invitation.
Thank you, Gustavo. It was quite enlightening, and basically like concise with the points of Evandro. I love, and then maybe you're gonna see where my heart is, like when you mentioned some sustainability elements, for instance, the no-till production, and because like I have circular economy in my heart, and of course this has to do with the regeneration of natural systems. So I wanna learn more about that, if not now, later on at some point. Like what you mentioned, and this is like a question that I'm going to have later on for you, is like what's needed in terms, and you did mention this, the idea of like adding like a mitigation adaptation really as part of like programs of climate change, like of the countries, and the market access conditions to favor these kinds of like the sustainable biofuels. So thanks a lot again, and with that I would like to give the floor to Jose Ricardo. And Jose Ricardo, in that case, I want to ask, do you have a presentation? Yes, I see my back. So please go ahead. And again, let us know when you need to have the slides change. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. Good morning, Carla. Good morning, everyone. Gustavo, hola. Hola, Evandro, ¿cómo está? Bien. Thank you. Thank you for this invitation. It's a great pleasure to be here to talk about you, what is important for this industry. I'm Jose Ricardo Botelli. I'm the CEO and Director Executive from Nauta, the Latin American Caribbean Air Transport Association. And it's a great pleasure to be here in this panel with this panelist in order to talk about this very, very important subject for us. As all you know, in 2016, as we know actually, The transportation is responsible for about 14% of the CO2, but the air transport is just 2.5. And even with this number, in 2016, the entire industry with the governments and together with the ICAO, the International Civil Aviation Organization, that is the House of Aviation and also is UN agency, did the framework for our industry until 2015, which means that we have an I'm doing just an introduction about this topic, okay? Is that which means that we have a wall in 2050. So since 2016, we start to work in order to save the problem or to solve the problem in Latin American Caribbean region. And why this was so important? This region has a tremendous potential. We heard here about Brazil, we heard here about Argentina, we can talk about Colombia, Paraguay, and many others. Because we have the materials, we have the foodstock, you know, to produce stuff in our region. But with the pandemic, after the pandemic, as if we can say this way, what we see is this region, when you're talking about the aviation, is growing very, very fast. The number now right now that we have, we are the fastest region when you talk about growth and demand for aviation, which means that more than ever, we need to talk again, we need to sit again in a table, states and the industry in order to do not agenda for the industry, not agenda for the government, but a state agenda, because this is very important for all of us. Next slide, please. I have just three slides. As we see here, let me put here because I cannot see the over there. Why is what we call SAF, sustainable aviation fuel, is so important for us? Because as I said, since 2016, this industry has a commitment in order to go for carbon zero in 2050. But how can we achieve that? Part of that was we know that is carbon offsets. The other is to have better infrastructure. And in Latin American Caribbean region, we are doing a lot about that. And also new technology. This industry is doing whatever is possible to bring new technology. Evandro said something here and Gustavo as well. We have hydrogen airlines, electric airlines trying to do something. But as we know, there is no silver bullet. And as we know, 65% depend on SAF. So what is the point when you talk about sustainable aviation fuel? What is the point that a region as Latin American Caribbean, without trains to connect the country, without roads to connect the country, with a lot of islands, how can we do the better policy to produce this year? Because we know that we have, for example, palm in Brazil. We have Colombia with products as well. We have Chile with hydrogen. We have Argentina. But we don't have a facility to produce this year, which is a nonsense. And why is that? So we know that we have to, that, and that's the reason actually why Alta, we did the agreement with ICA in order to study the case and to support the countries to do what is the most important. Next slide, please. Let me see if we are in the same slide. Mm-hmm. I was talking about this slide. Sorry, because I have to, next slide, this one, yes. Let me come back here. Yes. What is important? We know that we have to bring investments and more than ever, investors. But how to do that? We need to have a good environment for business. And in Alta, and also with ICA, we have been talking with the government, because Gustavo mentioned this, and this is very important. Where is the policy? We need the backbone, we need the core in order to give support to the investors in order to come to this region to produce here, because this is a very, very important to produce this year because of the cost for the industry. But how can we do that? Because there is a huge discussion about mandates and incentives. The way that we see as an industry, 75% of the sustainable aviation fuel has been produced in USA, and the rest in other parts of the world and part in Europe. We truly believe that the policy, not with mandates, because this could increase the price, but we truly believe that the incentives, I'm not talking about subsidize something, but we're talking about a policy that incentives in this region is much better than mandates. And there is a lot of discussion about that. So in order to produce this in our region, we need the stability, we need the policy. And actually we don't have the policy, or in some countries, like Evander told here, that was approved in Brazil, is not in place. And that is the reason that we should think about why the biggest investor in this area went to Paraguay and not for the third biggest air transportation country in the world, which is Brazil. So we need this for the producers. And this is something that ALTA has been talking a lot with the authorities. We take this to LACLAC. LACLAC is the Latin American and Caribbean Air Commission that is made with the authorities in the entire region, in Latin American, Caribbean, and also in the Caribbean. So we took this to them, and we did it together, a resolution. We support them to do this resolution in order to take to the countries the vision to development of sustainable aviation fuel in order to help, because as I showed here, 65% of the carbon zero depends on sustainable aviation fuel for 2050. And I'll give you an example. Brazil, only Brazil, has the potential to supply the entire 34% of the entire world until 2030 with sustainable aviation fuel, if we put in place the regulatory or the right regulatory framework, which means that with all that I said, and I think this is my last email, because we can debate something. With all that I said, we truly think that if we go together, if we go for a table, we can find an agenda in order to put Latin America and the Caribbean region in place with the right policies. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Jose Ricardo. It's sort of a little bit funny because today I really have had the opportunity to listen to you, and also by coincidence, I was at another event that I'm learning a lot about, like SAF and even SAF Plus, and then we're gonna go jump into that. But like you mentioned again, you addressed one of the questions that I had, that is had to do what is needed. And you did mention the idea, the lack of policy, and you did like sort of open it and spell out a couple of like policy changes that are needed. It's amazing really how SAF is playing a big role with 65% of the contributions really to this net zero agenda. So clearly, and as you, Evandro, you said, like, it's not about one or the other, is let's look at the pool of options and move them all forward. So with that said, I wanna go and gonna, let me see the time, 4:15. I'm gonna make a couple of questions and then I'm gonna open to the public if they have questions. Otherwise I can jump in with always more questions. But I wanna go back and I'm gonna be a little bit of devil's advocate here. Like, on one hand, you have mentioned the concept of sustainability of the biofuel. There are some criteria, and I do have, before being the devil's advocate, I wanna ask, Are there any, like, Evandro, you mentioned sort of like some kind of, I don't know, it's to mention it, policy or support or standards. Is this something at the international level, or is it something really in terms of sustainability, or is it something said at the country level? That would be my first question. Because you did mention this thing of land use change. Gustavo, you mentioned that in your case, like, you were certified as of 2008, maybe I got the date wrong. But you did mention the no-till, the regenerative. So clearly there are a lot of features that make it sustainable. The transport element was also as well. But although maybe you're not deforesting, and there is the devil's advocate coming here, is you may be sort of like using the land that could be used, let's say, for food. So you can be pushing the agriculture frontier. So I just want to have a sense of, what's your standpoint of that? I'm pretty sure I'm not the only one asking that. And then maybe, how is this thing? How do you see it? Because at the end of the day, the main thing is that we want to be able to contribute as a whole from a systemic point of view, or not like solve one issue by like creating a problem somewhere else. So I hope that, please go ahead and we can start with Evandro, and then I'm gonna give the word to Gustavo and Jose.
I think that we have to think in two ways. First, the benchmark must be global, in my opinion. But we need to address, for example, for us in one important part of America, the patterns of the tropical agriculture. See, when someone say about food versus fuel in corn, ethanol in Brazil, the person doesn't know what he's saying, because corn in Brazil normally is a second harvest. You had soybean or cotton or something like this, and in a second harvest, you will have corn. Then I am using the same area, I am producing DDG for feed, for example, increasing the food viability, then we don't have problem with the benchmark of sustainability. This is important. It must be common. But when Europe sometimes looks at to Europe, they see us with their glasses. And they don't know the concept, for example, of two harvest, 2.7 harvest, three harvests that we have in Brazil, three harvests. Incredible, because we have technology and we have geographical conditions to achieve it. Then, yes, the common benchmark from one side, and the singular partners, patterns of the tropical agriculture.
Perfect. Thank you. I give the word to Gustavo or to Jose. Gustavo, if you have some words to share with us about this topic.
Yes, sure. Well, again, I agree with Evandro. It looks like that we have already prepared before, but it is not true, our presentations. First, this global benchmark. I absolutely agree. We need international standard, but need to be agreed not only by importers, but also by exporters. Because the main problem that we have right now is that the countries that we produce biofuels, we don't rule out conditions on the market. Conditions on the market have been drafted by importing countries without any knowledge about biofuels. So in general speaking, we have a lot of restrictions and not science-based regulations on biofuels. So we need to urge the way to try to tackle this situation with an international agreement needed to do it. The second point is about the way of production of this that you have already questioned to us. I think that when we are talking about biofuel, it is impossible to avoid, to tackle and to try to rule out about the system of the production of the raw materials. Talking about sugarcane, talking about rapeseed, talking about soybean and other crops. We need to adopt and have a full adoption of good agriculture practice. In our case, no-tillage system, which is the best regenerative agriculture model that can be achieved, that but should be adopted for the all the countries with the idea to adopt full technology package. Because the only way to reduce greenhouse gas emissions is not only to have extensive land of production, but to have a full adoption on technology. So there is a strong linkage about gene editing, biotechnology, good agriculture practice, and regenerative agriculture. So all the rules in an international arena that we need to develop on biofuels should be based on this kind of system of production.
Thank you. What about José Ricardo?
No, I just, I couldn't agree more, especially with Evandro. I think that when you look for this kind of topic, you have to look in globally. And from aviation, we can say this because in our system, the entire aviation system is global. So every time that we have one country that trying to do something that is completely different for the entire world, we have a problem in the system, because this is going actually affect another country and also the system. So I think that when you talk about this benchmark, this international benchmark is very important, but for sure and no doubt about that, especially as we have here on this table, in this panel, Argentina and Brazil, and I would add also Colombia in this package. I think that we have to take a look in this benchmark, bring the good things, bring the good model, and see the speciality that we have in each country. Because, and can we do that? This is the big question. Yes, we can. During the pandemic time, in the aviation, and I'm talking about the aviation because aviation is one of the most regulated industry. So under the umbrella of UN, in this case of ICAO, we did protocols, safety protocols, biosafety protocols to help the countries all together. I really think that considering this table, you consider this topic, ICA is a very important player in order to coordinate this with those countries and also with this, with the industry, because we are on the field. And not just talking about the aviation, but any industry. Yeah, we are on the field. We know how can we help all and work all together to solve the problem. I think that in this case, specifically in this case, ICA is a very important player to bring together the entire industry and to discuss not just the benchmark, the framework that's going to be, but also what's come for each country.
Thank you, excellent. And given that I have you there, and I'm gonna ask you a question that's very specific to the biofuels for like the SAF. I have had the opportunity while we are here at COP to go to know about what they, I don't know if SAF Plus is the correct name, but it's this whole technology has been tried. I know at the pilot level in Canada and in Chile, I met someone today that is about producing biofuels, but like from the extraction of CO2, plus hydrogen, green hydrogen. I know they're at the pilot level, but do you see it as something that where like efforts should be put as well, or is part of this matrix of options? I know it's because that pilot phase is expensive, but what's your view on that?
Mine?
Yes, because it's for aviation.
Yeah, okay. I think this is a very good question. There is, as I said, there is no silver bullet. Right now, the industry is testing everything that is possible. And What we know right now is that we need the support of the country. Alone, it's impossible to do. For the industry, it's impossible. In the slides that I showed here, you see that we have a lot of possibilities, but SAF is 65% of this resolution. But to do that, the main core is something that actually we don't have, especially in Latin American Caribbean, what is the policy. I think that once the countries, they call the industry, we are able to go for the table and say, hey, why not test this? Can we bring this industry to show the product? Is it possible for your country? So there is so many possibilities right now, but there is almost none policy right now around the world. And we really need it. I think this is the core for everything to start.
Perfect, thank you. So I wanna know where there's a question here from the audience. So let me give you my microphone.
Sure, thank you very much. My name is Lloyd Day. I'm the Deputy Director General of ICA. Thank you for joining us at this pavilion. An excellent panel. I wanted to say hello to my friend Gustavo. He helped us in our preparation for the Food Systems Summit with some very valuable contributions, and to Jose Ricardo as well. Eduardo Unica is an excellent organization. I'm from Washington, as you might be able to tell from my accent, and the voice and the power of Unica as a spokesperson for your industry in Washington has always been very powerful. My question, and I think we were just talking a little bit about it, is policy. And policy is very important for the promotion of the biofuel and renewable energy industry. But I got to tell you, it's corn-based ethanol for the most part in the United States. There's a lot, and a lot of the folks around here don't agree with using land for renewable energy. In the United States, fortunately, there's strong representation from farm states that are keeping corn ethanol going and active, and a real success story for the economies of those regions, just like sugarcane ethanol has been in Brazil and biodiesel as well. But we have this tension here, and it's here at the COP. We can feel it. What do you think is the future to overcome that tension, to have sensible policy that we will overcome the food versus fuel debates, but also the environmental and the carbon debates on top of that? So thank you for your presence again.
Well, I think we need to have a learning process, educational process in this moment, and not in the research, but in the education. ICA has a very important, not only because I have deep friends in this institution, but because I recognize a true whole. Because the people, for example, don't know that in corn ethanol, because now in Unica we have a sugarcane ethanol producers, but I have also corn ethanol producers, and you use only 30% of the corn to produce ethanol. 70% of corn you will produce in the oil or corn oil, and the DDG and other products for feed, for example. And feed means food I would say in some days. Every feed in some days is food for the human person. Then our experience in Brazil, for example, with corn ethanol is to have a growth of the feed, and this helps. You have a better cattle because you have an efficient cattle. It means less land, more production, more efficiency. And the people said in the past, oh, if you produce ethanol from corn, and then you will push the border of the crop of the harvest into the Amazon forest. No, it's the contrary. With corn ethanol in Brazil, we are reducing the use of land and for cattle, because you concentrate the process, you become the process more efficient with less time to put the cattle in the market. Then it's a win-win, because the technology is the best support for environment. And I would like to finish just saying my the expression that I'm loving to use, the R word, diet. And now we live in an end word. The R word, or sustainability, or production, or biofuels, or food. This word, diet, finish it, end it. Now we are living in an end world, production and sustainability, more efficiency and more reduction of CO2. This is the end world, not the old world, in my opinion.
Thank you. So Gustavo and Jose Ricardo, would you like to contribute here?
From my side, just a couple of answer. This dilemma about food versus fuel, it's an old one, but if you take just two cases, the case of actual corn to transform in bioethanol, the byproduct is fully dedicated for animal feeding. So more bioethanol production and consumption will develop more animal feeding products for cattle, pigs, poultry, and others. It is the same situation for the production of soybean biodiesel. The byproduct for this is a soybean meal, and the soybean meal is the main ingredient worldwide to produce animal production system, particularly in South Asian countries. So the way to try to give an answer to fuel security is more biofuel production. The second point is about climate change that you mentioned before. I think there are two conditions on biofuels quite positive. One is carbon sequestration. If we are talking about oil, gas, or even electricity, there are no carbon sequestration at all. So truly, we need to fulfill and to develop more biofuel policies in order to get carbon sequestration in any national mitigation and adaptation program after COP27. And finally, carbon savings. Carbon saving calculation worldwide point out that around 60% till 90% of carbon saving going from biofuel from diesel production or fossil production. So there are two conditions quite clear, and that's the main reason that we need to develop all of these policies worldwide.
Thank you.
Carla, I would like to add is I like the word that Evandro said here is education. We really think that education is very, very important, especially nowadays where we have the internet. And especially nowadays, when misconcepts can, you know, go to the end in the world, and that the people take this as a truth. I think the right information, I know that is not easy, but the right information is very important about this topic. And we saw this during the pandemic time. We saw a lot of information that was no technical information. We saw a lot of fears to flying, a lot of things to flying, countries shutting down the entire aviation. But when we got the right information, the studies, everything that was possible to do at that time, including delivery, the vaccine, including delivery cargo, a lot of things, the countries, they started to reopen or resume the flights, what was very important with the right information, which means education is everything. But one point that I would like to bring as well is that sometimes when you talk about environment, sustainability, we think that this is some people, they think that this is only a problem for the government and only a problem of this industry. No, what we see right now is that the industry, especially in aviation, we are very, very committed to bring something that is to go for the carbon zero. But what the message that we are trying to give to the people is that, listen, we are all together in this our house. We have to do something all together. We have to walk the talk. And I'll give an example. Sometimes the industry is compensating the carbon that is with the emission of the flight. But when you go and we send to someone, hey, you as a person, would you like to compensate your flight? Is, you know, just step in and say yes. They say no, which means no, this is not my problem. We have to bring this education that is, this is my problem as a person. This is our problem as a professional. This is our problem as an industry. This is our problem globally. So I think the main word Evandro said here is education.
So I don't know if I have the green light because we have already exceeded time. That's why. Okay, so they gave me the green light so I can
I'm sorry, the last one. My name is Marco. I'm from Guatemala. I remember Evandro visited us some months ago, and I have a quickly comment. In the morning, we heard, because today is the Biodiversity Day in this COP, and some of the comments of the scientists of IPCC say that the monocultures are dangerous for the climate change. I think I disagree with these comments. I think that we need to be near for this kind of assessment of research in the world. I am sure that biofuels are a great way to reduce the greenhouse gases. In Guatemala, industries, I saw a question that, what about Latin America? And in Guatemala, it's possible to produce the biofuels to use in the country. And probably we need only to change and improve our regulation to make the successful in the use of the biofuel in the domestic market. Thank you.
Perfect, thank you. And I don't know if you want to add, because I think I'm able to maybe answer that question in the sense that it goes very much in line with what Jose Ricardo, you mentioned before about like how this thing is not happening in Brazil and it has to do with like policy. So maybe it's the same issue. It's like, why is it not happening in Guatemala or in any other countries? At the end, it's like enabling an environment to make it happen. So unless you really want to add something, you raise your hand and you let me know. Otherwise, I would like to thank you, the three of you, but I would like to make some closing remarks. Yeah? So first of all, it's clear, and I'm really happy to know that we need to take into account all possible solutions. We should not be picky, and that's key. And so biofuels is a key element, and we need to have it into consideration. Okay, clearly there are two things that will enable this. Education, I think, is really important, and I'm completely for education in all aspects, not only about biofuel. So it's when we are having programs of this kind, it's not just about maybe talking to the ministries of agriculture, energy. So what about ministries of education as well? Okay. Then the part of policy. And I think there were lots of really well spelled out policies that would be needed. But then I want to bring something here is the fact I started the session asking who wanted to have it in Spanish and who wanted to have it in English. So we did a democratic process to select the language. And I would say we need to acknowledge that the world is formed by people who think differently. for instance, like I can agree with the need of like renewables, but I do agree also with the need of like the sustainability element that has to do with maybe the pushing the agriculture frontier, but even go beyond with what Evandro you mentioned, the idea that even the sort of the byproduct of this process is used to feed animals, and that could make the improve the efficiency of feeding animals. And we see that one of the main sort of like recommendations that was yesterday also in a methane panel, how at the end from the part of agriculture or like or food, they say we need to start cutting like animal consumption. So what I want to say is that whenever these measures, for them to really work, we need to do them with all the safeguards in place, involving different stakeholders. We really want broad representation, because we can think A, someone's going to think B, another one's going to think C. And we really need to come to the table, discuss and assess that there's no perfect solution. We need to achieve a balance. And that's the message I would like to use to close the session. So thanks for everyone. Thank you, Evandro. Thank you, Gustavo. And thank you, Jose Ricardo. A pleasure meeting you here. And thanks for also because you enlightened me in terms of biofuels.
Thank you. Thank you.